Okay, so this is the third lecture, and in this lecture I would like to show you the minimal realization of the composite X model, I mean the minimal realistic one, which has really electroweak symmetry breaking like in the standard model, and also partial compositeness concerning the way in which we introduce the fermions. Okay, so let me start from the minimal composite X model. Okay, and this is generalizing what we saw yesterday about SO3 broken to SO2 in a very simple way. So you will consider an SO5 group broken by the composite sector to SO4. Okay. And in this case, the adjoint of the group is the 10 representation. And it decomposes under the SO4 group in a way which is a 6. And this 6 is the adjoint of the SO group itself, plus an extra representation that, as I remind you from the general knowledge of the Gorson theorem, this extra representation, the one that comes together with the adjoint of the unbroken group, is the representation under which the Goldstones, okay, the Goldstone boson transform under this SO4. Okay? So you're gonna get Goldstones in the four of SO4. So explicitly, let's write once again the generators. No, not explicitly, but let's write the generators, which are in the 10, and there are the ones in the 6 in the adjoint, the TA, and the broken ones, TA at. Okay? So again, 6 SO4 generators, say unbroken ones with the notation, so quote unquote unbroken and quote unquote broken, these fourth ones with the same terminology we used yesterday. Okay? So basically, you already see that from this breaking, there are four real Goldstone bosons that are going to appear. Okay? And this matches the number of components of one complex X doublet. Okay? So we are at least on the right track. Remember that the requirement that we have when we construct a composite X model with G broken to H is that H, which in this case is SO4, okay, must contain the electroweak group. So you may wonder why the hell I started from this SO4, and if you don't know that, I would like to convince you now that this SO4 indeed contains SU2 left cross U1 hypercharge, that is, it contains the electroweak group, okay? And it also contains another important symmetry that is called custodial symmetry. So I want to motivate why the minimal composite X model is made with this coset, and in particular why it's made with this SO4 unbroken group. And the reason is that SO4 has the same algebra, so we say it is equivalent, or it's locally equivalent to a direct product of two SU2 groups, SU2 left cross SU2 right. I will briefly show this because this allows me also to introduce some notation that will be useful in what follows. So that is the chiral group, so it's independent and unrelated SU2 left and SU2 right transformation. This piece, SU2 left, commutes with this one, with the SU2 right, and the commutation of the generators in between are just those of the usual SU2. We can consider one representation of this group, which is called the B fundamental of the group, which is denoted as 2,2. And this means that it's a 2 representation for what concerns the SU2 left, and also it's a 2 representation for what concerns the SU2 right, or explicitly the sigma matrix transform as sigma that goes to G left, which is the SU2 left transformation, times sigma times G right dagger. Okay? Furthermore, this 2,2 is a pseudo-real 2,2, so it is a matrix which is subject to an extra condition, which is that the conjugate of this matrix is equal to sigma 2, sigma 2. And you can check by yourself that this is a consistent restriction, which means that if I start from a matrix that obeys this condition, if I act with the group, I end up with a matrix that also obeys this condition. So that's a valid restriction that in total gives us to this 2 by 2. You see this matrix is 2 by 2. There is G left, which is in the two representation, G right in the other representation here. So this is a complex 2 by 2 matrix, which a priori would have 8 degrees of freedom, but after this condition, it has only 4 real degrees of freedom. And so the sigma matrix can be written in terms of 4 real numbers, which will eventually correspond to the 4 real components of the 4-plate of SO4. Okay? So this is something like 1 over square root of 2, I sigma alpha, the 3 Pauli matrices, pi alpha. I'm calling this pi because they are going to be the Goldstone bosons in our theory, and in particular they're going to be the components of the Higgs, these guys, plus the identity, the 2 by 2 identity, multiplied by the fourth, pi fourth, okay? And now we can check by using this specific representation that the two groups are locally isomorphic, because you can take the trace of sigma dagger sigma, okay? You can compute it and discover that it is the modulus of pi square, okay? So it's the norm of pi. You can also check that this trace is invariant if you do this operation, because you get only G right and G right on the and G right dagger on the left and on the right. The trace is cyclic, so chiral transformation SU2 left to SU2 right preserves this trace, which means it preserves the norm of pi. Okay, and you also know that SO4 is defined locally as the group of the most general rotations you can do, okay, on the 4-plate pi. So this tells us that any SU2 left cross SU2 right transformation must actually be an element of SO4, so it acts as an element of SO4 on pi, so SU2 left cross SU2 right is contained inside SO4, or it's equal, but then if you count the number of generators, you discover that SO4 has 6 generators, SU2 left cross SU2 right has also 6, 3 from here plus 3 from there, and it can be shown that there cannot be two Lie groups, which is one the subgroup of the other, and they have the same number of generators. The only possibilities is that they are equal, or better said, they are locally equal, in the sense that they are equal only for transformations which are closely connected to the identity. Okay? This means in particular that so we can, for our purposes, continuously switch from the SO4 or SU2 left or SU2 left or SU2 right notation. And so it also means that the generators of SO4, okay, this T little a here, okay, so they actually obey the same algebra of SU2 left cross SU2 right, and so they can be split into two sets, a T alpha left and a T alpha right, okay, with alpha going to 1 to 3. Well, these two sets commute with each other, okay, which correspond to the fact that this is a product of groups, and the algebra of these two subsets is just the one of SU2. Okay? So that's going to be our notation for the the SO4 generators, okay, written in this basis, in this SU2 cross SU2 basis. There is another couple of other things that that are going to be useful in what follows. So this sigma field, okay, so now you see, so SO4 is made of this SU2 left cross SU2 right, so when we identify the standard model group inside here, the obvious thing to do is to identify SU2 left factor as the SU2 left of the standard model, okay, and to go and look for the U1 hypercharge to be inside this SU2 right, okay? So what we are going to do, we are going to identify the electroweak group as, this SU2 left is equal to the SU2 left, and the U1 hypercharge is corresponds to a generator Y, which is the third right-handed generator of the SO4. Okay? And so now we can also read from here how the Higgs doublet will be made, I mean, what the Higgs doublet will be made of. Okay? So one SU2 left transformation acting on this sigma 2 by 2 matrix, it corresponds to acting with SU2 left on the left. Okay? While the hypercharge corresponds to a rotation of SU2 right, which is diagonal because it's just, say, the exponential of the third SU3 right generator, which is sigma 3 over 2. And so this operation corresponds to the following identification of sigma with the Higgs. Okay? So this sigma matrix, we can write it as H conjugate H. Okay? So H is the column of doublets. So H is just the standard model X doublet, H up, H down. HC is I sigma 2 H star. So it's the conjugate X doublet you encounter also in the standard model. Okay, HC transforms exactly like a doublet under the SU2 left. So you see that both the columns transform like doublets. And so this is consistent with the fact that we want SU2 left to act as matrix multiplication from the left. Okay, so line times column, this gives that SU2 left acts on this thing exactly as it has to be, in the sense that it treats the Higgs as a doublet. Then HC has the opposite hypercharge as H, okay? And this is correct because the hypercharge is going to be here the conjugate of G right, which is going to be the exponential of the, so e to the I T3 right, which is going to be plus or minus 1/2 above or below. So by this identification, we identify an X doublet, which, as in the standard model, lives in the 2 1/2, okay? So in the doublet with 1/2. Hypercharge. Okay. We can now that we have the map between the complex X doublet notation and the pseudo-real 2 by 2 matrix notation. Since we know what the pseudo-real matrix is in terms of the 4 plus pi, we can finish the exercise and derive the map between the Higgs and the pi's. Okay. So these 4 real pi's will be equivalent to the Higgs. And the equivalence goes like that, H. So H up, H down is equal to 1 over square root of 2, pi 2 plus I, pi 1, pi 4 minus I, pi 3. Okay? And we are always going to use independently all these different notations. Okay? Of course, the four-plate notation is the one which is more useful to formulate the nonlinear sigma model, but in the end, we want the Higgs doublet notation. Okay, so that's the first, now I hope you are convinced that inside SO4 there is the standard model group that we need, but there is also custodial symmetry. I think Peskin lecture discussed a bit custodial symmetry, so I will go fast. So custodial symmetry is the following observation. If the Higgs takes its BEV, which is the first component equal to 0 and the second component is real, V over square root of 2, okay, then the sigma matrix, which is written here, just becomes proportional to the identity. So the BEV of the Higgs written in the sigma matrix notation is V over root square of 2 times the identity, okay? And so you see that it does not break completely this SU2 left cross SU2 right group. Remember, this was acting as G left on the left and G right dagger on the right. So this configuration, which is proportional to the identity, preserves transformation in the vector subgroup. So you can check, I mean, obviously, BEV of sigma under a transformation which has G left equal to G right equal to G vector, well, it remains the same, okay? It remains the same because you have GV dot sigma GV dagger, okay? Given that this is proportional to the identity, I can commute and I get the same, okay? So even after electroweak symmetry breaking, there is a symmetry that remains in this theory, given that there was this original SO4, and this symmetry is SU2 vector, also called SO3, which is the same as SU2 custodial symmetry. Okay. The reason why this symmetry is important is that the coupling, and I think Peskin explained this to you, the coupling of the W left, which occurs with this generator here, okay, do not break this symmetry. So under custodial, the W mu alpha fields of the standard model form a triplet of custodial, okay, and this offers a certain number of selection rules, in particular in the mass of the W's, okay, that makes this more easily compatible with observations. Okay, so I will not enter into details, but you will see an effect of custodial symmetry in a couple of minutes, but just remember that to build a reasonable composite TX theory, if you don't want to do an enormous fine-tuning, an enormously small xi, you need to have a group, an unbroken group, which not only contains the electroweak group, but it also contains this enlarged SO4, which is SU2 left cross SU2 right. Okay, so aside from this little group theory complication, the minimal composite TX Lagrangian is just have the same form of the one we wrote in the abelian example. So we are going to take a scalar field. Of course, this scalar field now is a phiplet of SO5. It's not a triplet of SO3. It's a so transpose d mu phi. Okay, we are going to add the potential minus g star square over 8, phi transpose phi modulus square minus f square, okay? Just the same one you had before. Now the covariant derivative is obtained by gauging the SU2 cross U1 generators, and we already decided how to do that. In particular, we are going to have that, so the W mu alpha gauge SU2 left, and the generators, we call them T alpha left, so minus I G prime D mu, this is the hypercharge gauge boson, that gauges the hypercharge, which we identified as T 3 right, okay, applied, of course, that's the one derivative of phi, applied to phi, okay? So this is what we mean when we say that the electroweak interactions are introduced by gauging, okay, are introduced by plugging into the covariant derivatives, or if you want, by coupling the gauge fields to the current that corresponds to the appropriate generators that we have chosen to represent the standard model group. Okay, and all the derivations we did last time can be done in exactly the same way. In particular, you can go to a nonlinear basis, which is going to be phi equal to the Goldstone matrix U of pi acting on F plus sigma, right? Sigma is going to be the resonance, okay? And once again, it has the mass, I remind you, M sigma equal to M star equal to G star F. And the pi's are going to be the massless Goldstone boson. Now we have 4 of them, as I told you, and the Goldstone matrix, just to be explicit, the Goldstone matrix U of pi is e to the I square root of 2 over f, so even the same normalization we had last time, pi I t at I, okay? Where now, of course, the sum runs over the all four indices, okay? So we can work out everything like before. And I'm going to give you the result for the Lagrangian for this Goldstone X in the unitary gauge. Okay? So let's go to the unitary gauge where H is equal to 0 V plus H over square root of 2. Okay? Capital V is the BEV of the composite X. This is the fluctuation. And let's see what we get. So we get the usual kinetic term for the Higgs that stays alone. Then we get, and here is where custodial symmetry is going to play a role, we get F square over 8 sine square V plus H over F that multiplies. So there is G square, the mass term for the W, so W1 square plus G square W2 square plus the following thing, GW3 minus G prime B square. Okay? And custodial symmetry is what is ensuring that in front of this third term here, in front of this plus here, there is just a 1. Okay? And the reason is that when there is no hypercharge, okay, and only the SU2 left gauge bosons are gauged, custodial symmetry is unbroken, and the three Ws form a triplet of this symmetry. And so this mass term must be compatible with this symmetry, and so the mass, say, must be W1 squared plus W2 squared plus W3 squared up to only one coefficient, which is G squared. Okay? So that's essential that here we have 1, and that is enforced by custodial symmetry, as it happens, of course, in the standard model. And then, as in the standard model, okay, what we are going to find here from this square bracket is an expression that that is G squared times the charged W mass modulus square. There is actually a factor of 2 coming from the square root, plus 1 over 2 the cosine of the Weinberg angle square Z squared. Okay? So here I just made the usual Weinberg rotation to go from W3 and B to the Z and to the charged, and I switched to the charged complex notation for the W field. And from here you see that, the usual relation between the W and the Z mass, okay, that you have at three level in the standard model is present at three level also in this, theory. So the relation I'm talking about is, of course, mw square equal to cw square mz square, right? So when this takes a BEV, this gives a mass to these guys, but it gives them with this ratio, okay, in this form. Okay. So as you know, in composite ticks, I can always recover the standard model in any situation. So even if I had started with a model without custodial symmetry, I would have still found this relation, but with corrections, okay? With corrections that come from some complicated trigonometric function that can be different here than there. And this would have been a big phenomenological problem because it would have required a very small xi, right? A very small xi parameter. Okay, so here we see now electroweak symmetry breaking, so in particular how the W and the Z get the mass from this first term. In particular, we find that the W mass is 1 half GF sine V over F. Okay? And in analogy with the ordinary standard model, where just the formula is MW equal to 1 half GV, let's call V all this part. Okay? So this has to be fixed at 246 GV. Okay? And it is determined by a combination among the composite X VEV, capital V, and F. Okay? We also compute psi, which is V square over F square, and we find that it's given by sine square V over F. Again, it's the sine square of the misalignment angle, as we argued on general grounds, and we verified also in an explicit example. And then I can expand the sine square and find the x interactions, 1x, 2w, 2x, 2w, 3x, several w's, and similarly to what we did in the abelian case, and only that now we are talking about the real, word Higgs, something that could be really present. And so let me rewrite the result, which, by the way, is identical. So we have a modification of the coupling to w and to z, with a single Higgs that come from expanding this at the first order, which is universal for the W and for the Z, and this is again the consequence of custodial symmetry. And so it's called kappa V, which is Higgs vector in, composite Higgs divided by G Higgs vector in the standard model, which is the one we already see, square root of 1 minus psi. Okay. Please.
So you said if we don't have the symmetry, we can be a very small xi.
Yeah.
So
Yeah, the question was how bad would it be if I didn't have custodial symmetry in my theory? In practice, what you have to imagine that rather than finding sine squared, so this trigonometric function factorized out here, okay, you will find one trigonometric function for the charged Ws and one different one for the neutral part. Okay? Of course, in the limit f going to infinity, they all both, everything goes to the standard model because of the usual vacuum misalignment mechanism, but the deviations are of order xi, are of order b squared over f squared, sine squared b squared over f squared. So, basically, you would have found, in the case of no custodial, a correction of order xi to this relation. Now, this relation, this relation has been measured very precisely. The corrections from this identity come in the standard model from loop effect. So loop effect of the standard model correct, roughly speaking, this relation by around 1%. The measurement is at around 1 per mil, and the 1% works with the standard model, and so this means that you can tolerate deviations into this relation, which are not due to the standard model, so you can tolerate extra deviations of the order of per mil at most, which means xi equal to 1 per mil, or tuning equal to 1,000. Okay. So if there are no more questions on this part, okay, I will move to the fermions. So this is the leading or good question. So you can view this in several ways. Okay, so. You can view this as the low energy effect, okay? The full low energy effect that you find in the theory, including the exchange of heavy resonances. So basically what I claim is that this result for the X-Cabin modification is the one that you have at leading order in a derivative expansion, okay? So it is subject to corrections, which typically are not very important. This is why I stress so much this result, which are controlled by, basically the W mass over the resonance mass square. Okay, so they are typically negligible with respect to that. They come in the full, nonlinear sigma model analysis from higher dimensional operators. Okay, while these ones are only the ones of dimension two, of two derivative order. Okay, so there are corrections, but they are small. Yeah, it's also important to remark that even though I derived this coupling modification in an example model, it is possible to show that, as far as this calculation is concerned, the dynamics of the Goldstone boson is universal, and these results are really universal at the leading order in the derivative expansion. Okay. But to show this will require more techniques that I'm not going to introduce. Okay, so now basically for gauge sector we made it, okay? We have a model with gauge fields and the X field, electrosymmetry breaking giving mass to them, and so on. Now we have to worry about fermions. So we need to generate fermion Yukawas. And of course fermion masses. After the X takes a value. Okay. So here it's interesting to make a digression before to introduce the partial compositeness framework because it's an interesting quantum field theory subject related with the alternative to partial compositeness. So I told you that we're going to do this by partial compositeness, but that's not the way in which fermions get their mass in the standard model, and this is not the way in which the fermions get their mass and their Yukawas in, the old-fashioned technicolor models. So let me first do a first attempt to generate these Yukawas in the following way. Okay, that's the old-fashioned technicolor way. So what I need to do? Okay? I need to write down some interaction of the fermions. Remember that the fermions were living in a different sector, in the elementary sector, okay, while the Higgs was in the composite sector. Okay? And so I have to write some interaction among the elementary sector and the composite sector. Okay? And remember, I'm willing to believe that this theory is going to be generated at a very high scale, which I called lambda UV. Okay? And then it flows until the confinement scale M star. Okay? And the physics I'm studying is at M star, but I would like my theory to be well defined starting from a UV scale which is far above M star. So what I want to inject into a theory is an assumption on this interaction Lagrangian at the scale lambda UV. And the first thing I can do to make the fermions interact is by writing bilinear couplings. So I will have my composite sector that perhaps it delivers a scalar operator, which I call OS, okay, that happens to have the quantum numbers of the Higgs field. Okay, that's not difficult to imagine that. And so I can write something like Q bar OS. Actually, here I will need OS C, which is the I sigma 2 OS star conjugate, like for the Higgs, T right. Okay. So perhaps that's the leading, so the lowest dimensional interaction I can write in my theory, perhaps this is the leading, that's the leading interaction, which OUC obviously makes Q and T talk with the Higgs, the Higgs takes a web, and so makes Q and T get a mass, okay, at low scales. This operator has a coefficient, which I called lambda T, and it has, however, it must have the correct energy dimension, and we don't know what is the dimension of the scalar operator. Let's call it D, and so here we have to put lambda UV to the D minus 1, okay? That's the usual dimension analysis exercise we did the very first lecture, so if you have the physics scale where you are writing your interaction is lambda UV, then lambda UV weights all the dimensionful interactions, okay? And then I could write the same thing, a similar thing for the bottom. This operator OS, I said, must have the quantum numbers of the Higgs, so must be in the 2 1 half of the electroweak group. And again, D is equal to its dimension in energy, dimension of OS. Okay. Actually, that's the way in which the fermions communicate with the Higgs in the standard model. And there is particularly simple what we have. We just have one elementary operator, OS, which is the Higgs doublet, okay, that has a dimension equal to 1. Actually, here when I speak about dimension, I'm most properly speaking about scaling dimension, which need not to be exactly integer, and indeed they are not integer, not even in the standard model, there is some amount of anomalous dimension. So the dimension is close to 1, but not exactly 1 in the case of the standard model theory. Then there are other examples, like Technicolor. In Technicolor, this operator was completely different, was a fermion bilinear. Was two technifermions, okay, so new particles with the Technicolor gauge group, which made a bilinear. And so given that in Technicolor, the strong sector was almost a free theory at very high energies, the dimension of this thing was more close to 3, okay, because it's a fermion bilinear, than to 1. Okay. Now, there is a problem with this picture. There's a structural problem with this picture that comes if, so there is a problem if D is larger than 1. Okay, significantly larger than 1. And the problem is that if D is significantly larger than 1, this interaction operator which I've written is a high dimension operator. It's an irrelevant operator, has a dimension larger than 4. And so its effect at low energies are gonna be rather small. Okay? What we can do is that we can define the effective strength of lambda t. Lambda t was the coupling I defined in the UV. I can define an effective lambda t coupling strength at the scale m star, okay, that is at the scale of confinement where I want to define, where I want to see the implication of my theory in the following way. So the lambda t comes together with this 1 over lambda uv to the d minus 1, okay, so better be here a lambda uv d minus 1 into the numerator. And on the numerator, I put the typical scale that corresponds to the processes which I'm interested in, okay? So which is m star. So m star to the d minus 1 times lambda t in the UV. Okay? So basically what I'm saying is that the coefficient of the operator, which is lambda t over lambda uv to the d minus 1, will appear in, will affect processes at low energies, okay, only in a dimensionless combination, okay, because I want a dimensionless thing, which is m star to the d minus 1 over this one, okay? This can be done precisely by Kalman-Szymanski running equation, but doesn't matter much. Here the point is just that now the effect of this operator can be tremendously suppressed if d is larger than 1, because m star over lambda uv is very, very small. So in particular, the first thing I would like to get out of this is the Yukawa coupling, and in particular the Yukawa coupling of the top quark. That's why here I started from the top Yukawa terms, because that's the one which is problematic. And the Yukawa of the top will be exactly proportional to this lambda t written here, okay? And so it will be, let's write it once again, m star over lambda uv, everything to the d minus 1, lambda t, okay? And this can become a huge suppression if there is a big scale separation between m star and d, m star and lambda uv, okay? So the problem here is that we are not gonna be able to reproduce a sizable enough top quark Yukawa if d is not close to 1, and if if the hierarchy between m star and lambda uv is what we, is large enough, okay? After all, we wanted all this thing to explain why, I mean, to explain the size of the Higgs mass that will emerge after compositeness tricks and everything from M star, but the main point was here we want to explain a big hierarchy between lambda UV and M star. And here we are not able to do that. Okay? Now, one can play around with numbers and try to see which is the maximum lambda UV that you can get. Well, this depends on how large can it be, the lambda t coupling in the UV. Typically, there is a bound of perturbativity, so I could be more precise here. But so imagine m star over lambda UV of the order, I don't know, of 10 to the 12, okay, which corresponds to a 10 to the 15 new physics scale here. You imagine that this is an enormous suppression. Okay? Of course, this was for d larger than 1. For instance, in the standard model, there is not this problem because this is over the 1. However, in the standard model, there is another problem, that is the fact that the Higgs mass term is, say, dimension 2. So as we saw in the first lecture, is the guy that provokes, that causes the arising of the hierarchy problem. So people have been considering the possibility of some hypothetical theory where the dimension, like similar to the standard model, is close to 1, but not exactly 1, is 1 plus epsilon. Okay, such that after all, this is not a big deal, and you can eliminate this big suppression. However, some other people showed that if d is 1 minus plus epsilon, so if the dimension of OS is 1 plus epsilon, okay, in a general, even strongly coupled near conformal fixed point theory, in complete generality, well, then the dimension of the square of the OS operator is equal to 2 plus order epsilon correction. Okay. In the standard model, this is close to 1, and indeed the X mass term, which is OS square, has dimension 2. Now, the X mass term or OS square are dangerous operators because they are singlet operators. They are operators that can be put inside the Lagrangian. And so if you have one such operator of dimension 2, or close to 2, you do reintroduce the hierarchy problem. You will need to have only operator of dimension larger than 4 not to have the hierarchy problem. So this result implies that basically there is no way out, okay? We cannot expect any theory that gives a realistic top Yukawa, which has a big gap as we want to have, and at the same time does not suffer of the hierarchy problem. Okay? Because it will always have in its own Lagrangian an operator of dimension close to 2. So it will always be something like the standard model. Okay? So, and this is the main motivation for considering alternatives and for considering partial compositeness. And I stress this because partial compositeness has a lot of implications, physical implications, so it's better to understand where it comes from. Partial compositeness is this idea. That the interaction Lagrangian now is not made of bilinears, but is made of linear couplings. So now you have something like Q bar left. And now you have some strong settler operator, which now is not a scalar anymore. It's a fermion. It's a fermionic operator, which we call here OF T left. Okay? Well, it mixes with the Q left, third family doublet. And the strength of the interaction, we call it lambda t left. And now here the scale will be at the power d left minus 5 over 2. Okay. Similarly, I need to couple the top right to make, in the end, the Yukawa happen to arise. So lambda top right, lambda uv, dimension d right, which is the dimension, well, these are the dimensions of the corresponding operators, minus 5 half, OF d right. Okay. So now what is the difference? Well, now the difference is that, there is not much different from before, only numerics changes. So now we have that the effect of these couplings, for instance, lambda t left at the scale m star, can still be suppressed by an amount m star over lambda uv, okay, to the d left, let's say, minus 5 halves. You see where these 5 halves come from, right? Comes from the fact that, sorry, I forgot the top right. Comes from the fact that here you always have one elementary fermion, which has dimension 3 halves, and so here you want to get dimension 4, and you do this by this d left minus 5 halves. So now there is this this power here, d left minus t left, lambda t left. So now what do you need to have are fermionic operators, to avoid the big suppression, are fermionic operators which have a dimension close to 5 halves. So partial compositeness, in order to generate the top mass, requires the existence, okay, existence of fermionic operators with d close to 5 halves. Okay? Okay. So, is this okay or not? Well, clearly, even if you are very naive and you consider the square of this operator, so you take the square of this fermionic operator and you assign to it a dimension which is around 2 the dimension of the operator itself, so you consider something like OF bar OF, you end up with a dimension of 5, and which is not dangerous from the hierarchy problem, it's an irrelevant operator. Furthermore, there are examples of theories that obey all the rules of conformal field theories, which are the five-dimensional graphic theories, where these operators of dimension 5 halves are actually easy to obtain. They are there. What is somehow lacking in this picture is a microscopic realization of a theory with these one operators and with these specific dimensions. I don't think there has been still enough work on this because it's a very interesting subject. Of course, the simplest thing you can imagine is the following. To have an operator of dimension 5 halves, even in a weakly interacting free theory where the dimensions are just counted by energy dimensionality, you may want to consider an operator which is made of a scalar times a fermion. Like you have a scalar constituents weakly coupled to a fermion constituents. Okay? Of course, this requires a scalar, okay, to be made. And then it's better done in supersymmetric theories rather than in ordinary non-supersymmetric theories. Or there are possibilities like that this dimension phi alpha is generated because of the running towards a, because the, so the theory in the UV is not weakly coupled, it's strongly coupled, and so it has a fixed point with particular properties and seems not unlikely that one operator of dimension phi alpha, of scaling dimension phi alpha, can exist. Okay? So that's what we need to assume to do the top mass and to assume that still there is a hierarchy between M star and lambda UV, which is significant enough for us to be happy or satisfied. Okay. Okay. A couple of implications of this partial compositeness idea. So there is a striking implication, actually, which is which marks a big difference of this with the Technicolor way. So you see that now I'm writing, before I was writing like Yukawa-like objects, okay? And so the color index of the quarks was contracted, okay, implicitly between the quarks. But here I'm writing a linear coupling. So I'm writing Q coupled to O, okay? So to make this comply with QCD gauge invariance, it must be that O must carry QCD color. So this implies that the composite sector must carry color, okay? So the constituents of the composite sector must be must carry color charge, and the color group, so SU3C, must actually be a global symmetry of our group, of our theory. So basically, this immediately obliges us to enlarge the global symmetry content of our theory from SO5, that contains the standard model, was broken, to SU3 color times SO5. And not only this, this has important implication because if you have that the, say, the composite sector is colored, it's clear that it will also deliver colored resonances. So this makes colored resonances, which is something you did not even think to have in Technicolor, for instance, where, well, you had no reason for the composite sector, Technicolor sector, to be colored. Okay? Second, we can try to explain a little bit why this is called partial compositeness, which I still didn't do. Okay. So this has to do with the fact that here I have a mass mixing, right? Something like this. I have Q mixed with an operator. And I can view this more precisely in the following way. So this elementary composite mixing, let's just write it as lambda Q bar O. Okay? We reabsorb all the lambda UV scale powers inside the O, okay? Now, this operator O is supposed to be a gauge invariant operator, gauge invariant with respect to the strong sector confining group, okay? So OF is an observable operator. And as such, we expect it to be associated with particles. There is a sort of correspondence between operator and particles, which is the usual thing that an operator can interpolate from the vacuum for a field. So given that I have OF, I do expect to have particles with suitable quantum numbers, such as to be excited from the vacuum or destroyed from the vacuum by the operator OF. Okay. So they're going to be particles associated to OF. Associated means they have to have the same quantum numbers, otherwise this one would vanish. So the particles I have to have, okay. For instance, there is a particle Q, which belongs to the same representation as this operator. So let's spell it out, all of it. So this operator couples with the standard model left-handed doublet. So it is in the 2 1/6 of the standard model, we say that it also, the quark is also QCD colored, and this, for this reason we say that this operator has to carry QCD color. In particular, it's in the triplet of color, okay? And so we do expect to have, it's a fermionic operator, right? So we expect to have fermionic resonances with this one, quantum numbers at least. Okay. This resonance is going to be massive, so what we do expect are massive spin 1/2 particles, okay, associated with these operators that I'm calling Q. So out of this interaction term, when I write down a phenomenological low-energy Lagrangian that involves the quark and also the heavy particles, this will result, not surprisingly, in a mixing, okay, that I can conveniently parameterize as lambda times F, F is the Goldstone boson X decay constant, times Q bar Q. Okay, so that's just a mass mixing between the Q left, of course, and the Q. And this, so then you also have a mass term for Q itself, which is of the order of the M star scale, clearly, so M star Q bar Q. And so you have a mass matrix involving a Q left and Q right component, capital Q and little Q. Okay? So you diagonalize the mass matrix and you find that the physical massless eigenstate, which emerged from these two terms, is not exactly the Q, but it's a combination of little Q and capital Q. So the physical Q, well, before electroweak symmetry breaking, so the massless Q left guy, is actually going to be some cosine of theta, little Q field, so little Q state, plus sine theta, capital Q. Okay? Where this sine theta is the compositeness fraction, is the amount by which you have to rotate the matrix, right, to diagonalize this mass matrix, and you can immediately find that this sine theta is of order lambda F over M star, okay? And since I told you several times that M star, the resonance mass, we call it also G star F, okay? With this is lambda over G star, okay? So this is called partial compositeness because the physical states are partially, and by an amount which is sine theta, made of composite degrees of freedom. And this partial compositeness, so this holds, of course, for the Q, but of course it also holds for the top right, which was written there. You have lambda T bar right OF T right. And so in this case, you will have another state in the singlet, right, with the appropriate quantum number that is called T tilde. Okay? And then the thing works in exactly the same way. So also the top right is partially compositeness by an amount which is, however, so in this case, we have Q, so the coupling was Q left, so the amount of compositeness was lambda left, okay? In the other case, you will have lambda right. Lambda top left or lambda top right, okay? So, and this one, partial compositeness, is the thing that also makes it, in the end, the Yukawa originate, at least in a schematic picture. So, in order to make the quark talk with the Higgs, what do we have to do? The quarks are in the elementary sector, so they cannot talk with the Higgs before they go to the elementary sector. And to go there, they mix with the fermionic operators. So basically, all what makes the quarks interact with the Higgs is mixings, which then transforms the Q left and the top right in their corresponding Q and T partners. And then the Q and T partners are resonances, so they live in the composite sector, so they can interact with the Higgs as much as they like, okay? And they will do that with the strength, again, G star, okay? G star is and is going to be the typical coupling strength of all the vertices of the composite sector. And so this gives a diagram out of which you can generate the Yukawas of the quarks, in particular the Yukawa of the top. And you can estimate to be G star times the compositeness fraction, so sine theta left, sine theta right, which is, G lambda T left lambda t right over g star. Okay? Now the g star power for the moment doesn't matter much. Okay, that's the correct one. Here we just want to notice that the partial compositeness mechanism controls the generation of the Yukawa. And so how much are partially compositeness the fermions, that is how large or small I have to take this lambda t left or lambda t right, depends on how large or small I want to be the Yukawa. So for the case of the top, I know that I want a large Yukawa, so there's going to be a large compositeness fraction. Okay? While for the case of the other quarks, which have a very small Yukawa, well, this lambda left and lambda t right better be rather small. Okay? So the picture works with a large partial compositeness for the top, okay? And instead, a limited or very small or negligible partial compositeness interaction for the other quarks. Okay? In particular, this makes that the other quark have an hard time to interact directly with the composite sector, okay? And this is helpful in certain respect with flavor phenomenology, but not, okay. Okay, please. Okay, the question was the difference between the partial compositeness and the technicolor bilinear way. Let me tell you this once again. So the only difference is that in the bilinear way, the bilinear technicolor way, I'm sure I need the scalar operator of dimension close to one, and I'm sure that the scalar operator of dimension close to one reintroduces the hierarchy problem in my theory. Destabilizes the hierarchy between m star and lambda uv. And I'm sure about that because I'm sure that the operator scalar square, it's a singlet operator. It's something you can put in the Lagrangian. It's like the Higgs-Mass term. And so you have an operator of dimension less than two, around two, let's say, which would have a huge coefficient, and this destabilizes the hierarchy. While in the fermionic case, on one end, we don't have such a theorem, and we have good reasons to believe that such a theorem cannot exist, simply because 5/2 times five, plus 5/2 is 5, okay, and because we have examples. And so we think that leaving somehow close to 5/2 is reasonable, okay? Yeah, 5/2, but 5/2 is not a bad number, okay? So scalar operator of dimension 2 is a bad number. Dimension 1 is a bad number because it implies having a scalar square operator of dimension close to 2. Okay? Fermionic operator of dimension 5/2 is compatible, okay, with, can occur even in natural theories. Okay? Please. Yes.
You say that the quarks at VC and LHC are a mixture of the old quarks and the new quarks in some sense. But you still have more physical states, I mean, not just those that we observed.
Okay, the question. So the question was whether. Whether having discussed here only one resonance is enough or not. That's basically your question. Okay? Ah, okay. So, first of all, that one resonance it could be heavy, okay? It could be at 2 TV, and we have not yet reached that level at the LHC. But of course, we are searching for that resonance, okay? But it can be naturally heavy because it has a mass which is dictated by the composite sector confinement scale that indeed we wanted to take in the TV or multi TV region, okay? So, this guy is heavy, first part of the question. Second part of the answer is that that's an illustrative thing because you have to imagine that on top of this Q, there's going to be many other resonances. Okay? In particular, in strongly coupled sectors, there are towers of particles, okay? Replicas, with typically, say, some splitting in mass. So you can think to this as the lightest, okay? But this is not, okay, the complete calculation. Okay? This is a sketch. Other resonances are expected. Also in the fermionic sector. Okay? Okay, if there are no other questions, I can go to I can go indeed to a calculation. Okay, I can really show you. Well, first I will show you in detail. There is another question, please.
How does the coupling of the resonance with the Higgs look like?
How does the coupling of the Higgs to the resonance look like? Good question. The coupling of the Higgs to the resonances, which is this one here, okay, in principle, you have to be careful. They will be subject to certain selection rule dictated by the fact that this guy is in most of both. Okay? So I'm telling you that this one coupling is indeed present. Okay? It's indeed present, and it originates, intrinsically inside the composite sector. So you have to imagine this, pion to row scattering. Okay, in analogy with QCD. That's large, that's G star, that's a big coupling interaction because it's a strong sector interaction. So if it's not forbidden by some symmetry, this is the naive sites, okay? We do expect the naive sites common to all these couplings of the composite sector that here I'm calling G star. It was also in the Lagrangian. This is the same G star I put in the Lagrangian. And indeed, but this I'm gonna go back on this tomorrow, this G star also in that Lagrangian is precisely the guy that controls the interaction. For instance, the 3 sigma interaction is G star proportional to G star. And the 4 sigma interaction is G star square. And this has a reason for that. But okay, we will come back on G star tomorrow. Okay, let's build some sort of a model, or at least let's specify better the quantum numbers of these fermionic operators. So, already told you that the fermionic operators for the top left and for the top right have, now let's neglect color, okay? Let's ignore color for the moment, doesn't play any role. These are in the 2/1/6 of the electroweak group, okay? Like the corresponding doublet, and this is the 1/2, okay? This is what we could conclude from this formula, because of course we don't want to break explicitly the standard model group. However, these operators, okay, are the operators of the composite sector in the UV. Okay, so you should imagine, if one day we will know this theory, to write them in terms of these technical constituents of this theory. Okay, and to write them in a phase of the theory, which is far above the scale of explicit breaking of the Gorson symmetry. So I'm writing this operator in terms of constituencies for which the Gorson symmetry is still an exact symmetry. Okay. So said in another way, this fermionic operator will come as the product of constituents with their own global group G, which will be a Flavel group symmetry. All this is to say that actually these fermionic operators, we are not happy to know what are their standard model representation. We really would like to know where they live in terms of G representation. So the OF fill, okay, complete multiplets of G, okay, of the full global group, not even only of H, okay, really of the full thing. For instance, in Technicolor, psi bar psi is a 2,2. Of SU2 left plus SU2 right. In Technicolor, it's just chiral theory. And it's a full group, it's a full multiplet of the full group, even before the break. Okay? So these OFs, okay, are actually larger multiplets, okay, of G, that, and the only requirement we have on them is that they have to contain, okay, these components, these 2/1/6 and 2/3 components, in order to be capable to talk with the quarks in the way we say it. Okay? So let's make a couple of examples, which are the 5 of SO5 and the spinorial 4 of SO5. Okay? Here I'm talking about the minimal composite X model SO5. So let's see what happens to this 5. So this 5 of SO5. Let's first decompose it under SO4, gives a 4 plus a 1. Okay, the four, remember, is the representation where the Higgs lives. So I already told you that this 4 is actually equivalent to a 2,2. Actually, these are fermionic operators, so this is a complex 2.2, it's not a pseudo real 2.2. Okay, so it has twice the degrees of freedom. Plus one. Okay. So we know that the standard model acts like SU2 left here and U1 right here. So now we can further decompose this under the electroweak group of the standard model. And so we will get from the 2.2, so we're going to get A2 1/2, which correspond to take the doublet part here and the first of the doublet elements, okay, which has 1/2 because the hypercharge is 1/2. The hypercharge is T3 right, right? Remember, the hypercharge is the third SU3 right generator, so given that this is a doublet of the SU2 right, it has eigenvalues which are of T3 right, which are +1/2 and -1/2. In the case of the Higgs, this was a pseudo-real, so actually these two representations were one the C conjugate of the other, and so there was not doubling, but here there is doubling. Plus the singlet, which is a singlet under everything, so it has zero hypercharge. Okay? So clearly this one does not work, does not contain a 2.1/6 and not even a 1.2/3. You can do it for the 4. The 4 decomposes in a different, the 4 is the Spinorial of SO5, and it decomposes in the 2.1 plus the 1.2, which means basically that, so this is just a doublet of SU2 left that does not transform under the right, and this is vice versa. And so this 2.1 now is still a doublet of SU2, but now it's a singlet of SU2 right, so it cannot have any hypercharge, it has hypercharge equal to zero, while the other two have one, are singlets, okay? And then they have the hypercharge which is dictated by the T3 right eigenvalue, so there is 1 1/2 plus 1 -1/2. Again, nothing we can use to have a component we can make talk with the quarks, okay? And you can show by, if you are good in group theory, you can show that you are not never going to find quantum numbers that you like in SO5, okay? But we don't care of these details, and so what we do is that we further extend the group G, okay? So actually, that's a rather natural thing to do, and also, well, it's not particularly implausible, that your group is actually not SO5, but SO5 cross a U1X. Like before, we introduced the color group, and now we introduce this U1X global group. This is unbroken, the U1X. So 4 cross U1X. Okay. And the reason why we introduced this extra global charge is that because now we want to change our definition of the hypercharge. Because it was our definition of the hypercharge as T3 right that made these bad numbers appear. And so now what I want to do is to change the definition of the hypercharge generator from Y equal to T right 3. Okay? I want to make it become T right 3 plus X, where X is the U1X charge of the fermionic operator, which I'm gonna choose. So what I'm gonna do is to, if you don't mind, I can write directly here. I can have a fiplet with U1X charge of 2/3, okay? And then if I go until the end of the decomposition, I just have to add 2/3 to the hypercharge, and so I find a doublet with hypercharge 7/6, which is still not okay, but then I have a doublet with hypercharge 1/6, and a singlet with hypercharge 2/3, okay? So now I have the good way to couple the top right, and a good way a good components to couple the Q left. Okay. Please.
What would happen if you simply use the X charge
for the hypercharge? What would happen if I use the X charge for the hypercharge? Would happen that the X would be neutral, because the X leaves starts from a Goldstone in SO5, so its charges are fixed and can only transform under SO5. So if I just give X equal to U and X, the X would have no hypercharge.
Predict? Quarks which charge 5/3.
I predict charge question what which charges I yes. From this decomposition, knowing that these operators are also associated with particles, you can indeed read that there's going to be a doublet with 7-6 hypercharge, which contains an exotic charge X5/3 state in particular, in this case. In this other case, which is the fourplet, which is not very popular because it has troubles with the ZBB bar, so I'm not going to talk about this, but in this other option, it's different. This other option, you have a 4-1, so you have to give hypercharge 1-6 to the sink, I guess, yeah. And so you get a 2-1-6 plus a 1-2-3rd, okay, plus a 1-1/3. So you see that this is particularly nice because you can feed not only the top right and the Q left, but also the bottom right in the same representation. It's an aesthetic thing and it's no importance. But here in this case, you do not have exotic charges. But you are in trouble with some properties related with the ZBB bar. Okay. So I will now take, I hope, five more minutes to finish the exercise, so to start and finish the exercise of using this information which is written on the side of the blackboard to really compute the Higgs couplings modification, so the modification of the Higgs couplings to fermions. Okay? By using the formalism of non-linearly realized symmetries. So what I need to do that is first to do a trick, and then to do a calculation. So the trick is the following. So let's write our elementary composite interaction in the following way. The coupling, lambda t left, the operator, fermionic operator, or t left in particular. Now, we say this fermionic operator is actually a multiplet of the full S of 5. In particular, we're going to take the case of a 5. Okay? So we're going to take this case here. So this is a fiveplet, and so it has fiveplet indices, I, okay? I goes to 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, okay? And quarks are instead do not fill a complete multiplet, right? The Q left is only 2, and so this coupling is going to break the G symmetry. And the way we can visualize this is to introduce here, to write here something like Q bar T left, okay, I, not to be confused with the capital Q we had previously, okay? So this capital Q is just a fiveplet, an incomplete fiveplet made of the two components of the Q left doublet, okay? So basically this Q T left, I can write it explicitly, is 1 over square root of 2, minus I B left, minus B left, minus I T left, and 0. Why these numbers? So these are the right numbers, minus I, minus blah, 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 to select the components of this Q left, which now you see has 5 components, so it's really a fiveplet. This is just to select the components of the fiveplet that correspond to the doublet of charge 1/6. In such a way that when I multiply this with that, I really end up with what I wanted. So with the doublet mixed only to the components of the OF that have the right standard model quantum numbers. And for the top right, it's even more simple. I just define a capital T right, which is an incomplete fiveplet of very trivial form, top right down here. So it's only the last component of the fiveplet that is corresponding to a singlet, and so it's the guy which then gives 1/2 here. So this one I can write as lambda t right, t bar right I, of t right I. Okay? So this rewriting is sort of similar to the rewriting you do when you use spurions that Marcus explained to you. Here it's even a bit more simple. So that is the so-called method of sources that you may have heard already. That is the following idea. So suppose I want to compute the Yukawa couplings, or better, I want to compute all the couplings of fermions FF bar with the Higgs, okay, an arbitrary number of Higgs's. But I know that, the composite sector is the strongest sector, so it's the one that leads the most relevant result is the one that comes from pure strong sector interaction. Basically, I want to compute all the possible, I imagine computing all the possible diagrams where there are only, for instance, this one, a fermion mixing to another composite fermion, like similar to the one we saw before, then mixing again to an F with X's attaches, or even, loop contributions, like an F that goes into a fermion and some other composite boson with all the X's attached here. So I want to keep all this contribution, but I don't care of any diagram where the F elementary field is itself propagating. So for instance, this one I don't want to include. I will be able to include it afterwards, after having done the calculation that follows, by doing one loop of the result, of the resulting effective Lagrange. Okay? So this one with F inside, I don't want to put it. Okay? So, and this is a good approximation because this F results into elementary couplings, new elementary couplings insertion, new lambda T left insertion, which are weak. Okay? So if I want to do this, the fact that this capital Q and capital T multiples were incomplete doesn't matter at all. Okay? It doesn't matter because the only way you can say that this capital Q was not made of really five different fields is when you look at the kinetic term, at the propagators. Okay? Because then if you open this, you will discover that this B left as a propagator, while this one is set to zero, which means as if you want an infinite kinetic term. Okay? So it's only when you open the box of the propagators that you realize that these sources, so these fields here, are actually set, are actually being set to this specific value. And that's the method of sources. So you regard all these Q and T as an external source, again, a non-propagating external source, and you compute correlators, okay, by integrating out all the rest, all the composite sector, but not taking into account the propagation of the sources. This you can do, again, afterwards. And if you do use this trick, the things enormously simplify because QI now is a fiplet, and T right also is a fiplet. Okay? So as far as this calculation is concerned, I can, even if the symmetry is broken by the fact that this clear is not a fiplet, it's an incomplete fiplet, for instance, even if the symmetry is broken, I can still use the predictive power of the symmetry. So I'm gonna do quickly the following thing. So I want to get the effective Lagrangian, because I want the Yukawa couplings and all this, for the capital Q, for the capital T, and for the Higgs, which emerges as a pseudo-Lambo-Wolfson boson. And this I will do by imposing that this is SO5 invariant. So under SO5, the Q and the T transform as a fiplet. So let's say GQ, and this goes to GT. Okay? And how the X transform? Well, you know, it's complicated. It becomes simple only if you look at the Goldstone matrix, U of pi or U of H, okay? I'm continuously switching notation, Goldstone pi or Goldstone H is the same. So I told you that the Goldstone matrix under SO5 transforms into G U H to the minus 1, where G is the SO5 transformation itself, and H is a transformation inside SO4, which I repeat you once again. So H is a transformation inside the subgroup. So like we saw for SO3 broken to SO2, it's going to have a block diagonal form. There's going to be here a 4x4 SO4 transformation. Okay? And here there's going to be nothing. Okay? So which kind of terms I can construct? Now I think it becomes a very simple question. So take the Goldstone matrix to the minus 1. It will transform with H on the left and G dagger or G minus 1 to the right, and apply it to Q, for instance. Then the way this thing transforms is just that this goes into H, U to the minus 1, G to the minus 1, but then there is G from the Q transformation, and this cancels, and so you see that this guy here transform with H, U to the minus 1. So if I take the sources, I act on the with the Gorson matrix, I find something that actually does not really transform with S of 5. Okay? It transforms only as it was made of, so it was in a reducible representation of S of 4, because the matrix that acts on it is block diagonal. So for instance, the first four components of this guy, they transform like a four-pet of S of 4, while the last component does not transform at all. Okay? That is the essence of CCWZ in a simple example, a way to write down all these invariants in a systematic way. And so what one does, given this observation, is to take this U minus 1 Q and decompose it in the first four and in the last component. Okay? So for instance, you may have something like U to the minus 1 acting on Q, which is, again, a five-plet. You can write it as a four-plet, like this typically called dressed sources, because they are dressed by the U field, by the Gorson field. And these now are non-trivial objects, right? They contain not only the elementary fermions, but also the Higgs that comes when I multiply with U. So we typically have, in this case, you have a dressed source that transforms in the four-plet, and a dressed source that transforms in the singlet. Q, T left, dressed in the singlet. Okay? Okay, so... then let me just write down the result. If you have, I mean, questions, you can ask me next time. I want to end, now I have to stop, so I want to end with this before discussing the implication, but already this will be enough. So I will write down the most general zero derivative Lagrangian involving Q, T, and the Higgs, okay? And this happens to be basically the mass term for the dressed source. So this happens to be proportional. I don't have time now to discuss the proportionality factor to Q bar T left dressed singlet, T right dressed singlet, okay? So tomorrow we will see what is the proportionality factor and we will work this out explicitly. You see already that that's a non-trivial object, okay? I tell you once again, this depends on the Gorsons in a non-trivial way. So inside here, we are indeed going to find a lot of interactions. So like all interactions with two elementary quarks, so with the Q left and the top right. And then here, there will be the Higgs in many possible different powers coming from this complicated nonlinear structure. And in particular, we will predict the deviations of the single X coupling to two quarks. Okay? I stop here.